Hey there. So today we are going to be looking at two ways to prove the sine of theta plus phi identity, and then we'll also look at an honorable mention which I couldn't use to prove sine of theta plus phi, but the equation for sine of theta plus phi, but I could use it to prove the equation for sine of 2 theta. So I tried a lot, but I couldn't find a way to generalize it to theta plus phi, but I guess you guys can try something out. So now let's get started. So the first one is a bit of a long one, and we are going to be using the sine rule for this one, and that's why I need the notebook, because it's pretty long, I can't remember it. So first of all, we'll draw an arbitrary-ish triangle, and let's call that angle theta and that angle phi. So from the angle sum property of triangles, we know that this is 180 degrees minus theta plus phi. And now let's name the sides. So let's call this A, B, and C, and let's draw the perpendicular. And let's call this X and this Y. So C is actually just X plus Y. So we can write that over here. So you may think that we can write all of these lengths in terms of variables theta, phi, and A and B, but I'm not going to do that because then things will get really complicated. It's much easier if we give everything a name. So we'll also call the length of this perpendicular H. So that's a right angle, that's a right angle. So now the proof goes something like this. First of all, let's notice that sine of 180 degrees minus any angle, let's say A, is equal to sine of A. And we don't actually need the sine of A plus B identity to prove this. We can use the unit circle. So if you go back to the unit circle, this is A, let's say this angle is A, and then this is sine of A, this length, if this radius is 1. And similarly, we can also look at it this way. If we say that this angle is 180 degrees minus A, then this is A, since the entire thing is 180 degrees. And this length is sine of 180 degrees minus A. But then if you think about it, this is just a mirror image of this thing about the y-axis. So if you mirror this about the y-axis, you'll get this picture and vice versa. So that means that sine of A, which is this length, is the same as sine of 180 degrees minus A, which is this length. So now using this fact, we can actually argue that the sine of this entire thing is just sine of theta plus phi. And you may ask, why are we doing this? Well, that is because we need to bring sine of theta plus phi from somewhere, right? If we want an equation which is relating sine of theta plus phi to something else, we need to bring sine of theta plus phi from somewhere. And this is the place from where we'll bring it. And now if we use the sine rule, we can say that the sine of this angle divided by this length, so that by C, is equal to the sine of this angle divided by this length. So sine theta divided by A, and that is equal to sine of this angle divided by this length, so sine phi divided by B. And okay, so now let's use this triangle and this triangle, since they are right angle triangles, and we can talk about sine and cos using right angle triangles very easily. So we can actually say that sine theta is equal to H by B, opposite by hypotenuse, and cos theta is equal to y by b, and similarly sine phi is equal to h by a, and cos phi is equal to x by a. So now what we'll do is we can also talk about what sine of theta plus phi is. So sine of theta plus phi, using this equation, is C by A times sine theta. Okay, so now notice that we can write sine theta as H by B. So we'll replace this by H by B. But now we also know that c is equal to x plus y. So we can write this as x plus y over a times h by b. So now if we open up the brackets, we get x by a times h by b plus, and now I'll rearrange this term a bit. So we get y by a times h by b, but I'll write it as h by a times y by b. So h by a times y by b. And now you may see where this is going, because x by a is nothing but cos phi. So this is cos phi, and h by b is nothing but sine theta. So this is sine theta, and h by a is nothing but sine a. Sine phi. And y by b is nothing but cos theta. So now look what we get. Sine of theta plus phi is equal to cos phi sine theta plus sine phi cos theta, and there is our identity. Okay, so this next one is actually a proof for the identity of cos a minus b, and it uses vectors, and I've actually made a video on this before, but I'm going to explain it again because I want all of these related topics together in one video. So it goes something like this. Let's say we have our coordinate system, and let's make a unit vector a hat which is at an angle theta. So a hat is equal to the vector cos theta sine theta, and similarly let's make another vector b hat, unit vector, and it's at an angle phi with the positive x direction. So that means that b hat is equal to cos phi sine phi. And now what we'll do is we'll take the dot product. So b hat dot a hat is equal to, first of all, since they are unit vectors, this is equal to mod b hat times mod a hat times cos of the angle between them. And well, the angle between them is theta minus phi, or phi minus theta. But here, of course, we are assuming that phi is greater than theta. It may be less than theta as well. So we'll just take the mod right here. It doesn't really matter. So now notice that mod b hat and mod a hat are both 1, because they're by definition unit vectors, and cos of a, any angle a, is also equal to cos of minus a, which is easy to see using the unit circle. So if we say that this angle is a and this angle then will be minus a, and we can clearly see that cos is this length. So if we drop the perpendicular, then this length is cos a and this length is also cos minus a. So that means cos a is equal to cos minus a. So that proves that identity. But that means that cos of mod a is the same as cos of a, which is the same as cos of minus a, because we don't really care about the sine of a. So that means that this is the same as just cos of phi minus theta. We can just remove the mod without a problem. But now notice that since we defined a hat to be this and b hat to be this, we can also evaluate the dot product using another way, and that is by multiplying this and this and this and this and then adding them. So we get cos phi cos theta minus sine phi sine theta, which is the same as b hat dot a hat, and that means that cos of phi minus theta is equal to cos phi cos theta. Sorry, this is supposed to be a plus sine phi sine theta, and there is our identity. Okay, so now we come to the honorable mention. So the honorable mention is if we draw a rectangle with side lengths a and b, and then we draw the diagonal, and let's call the diagonal length C. So this entire thing is C. And now if we call this theta and we call this phi, then we know that this will also be theta and this will be phi, because these triangles are similar, this and this, sorry, they're actually congruent, they're not even similar, they're congruent, and that means that this is 180 degrees minus 2 theta, because these two angles add up to 2 theta, and as we already saw, sine of 2 theta is the same as sine of 180 degrees minus 2 theta. And now we'll use a pretty useful formula, which is the formula for the area of a quadrilateral using the diagonals. So if you have a quadrilateral, let's give it a name, A, B, C, D. Then the area of this quadrilateral is actually the length of the diagonals, so BD times AC times the sine of the angle between the diagonals, so that's 180 degrees minus 2 theta, or you can also say 2 theta. So sine 2 theta, we anyway know that they're the same, and this divided by 2. So this is equal to the area of the quadrilateral, but we have another formula for the area of the quadrilateral, which is A times B, height times base, since this is a rectangle, so AB. But now, what is BD and what is AC? BD is C, AC is also C, and sine 2 theta is something which we'll now find out what it's equal to. So sine 2 theta is equal to 2AB by C square if you rearrange this. But now what is A by C? Well, A by C is just sine theta. So sine 2 theta is equal to twice sine theta times, what is B by C? B by C is this length by this length, so that's cos theta. So we know that sine 2 theta is equal to 2 sine theta cos theta. Okay, so there's a really cool thing which I decided to add at the last moment in this video, and that is a proof for the Pythagoras theorem using multivariable calculus, which I came up with while playing around with right angle triangles and seeing where I end up. So this is like really cool. I can't describe how cool it is. So let's draw a right angle triangle, of course, first step in any Pythagoras theorem proof. And let's name the sides as x, y, and z. So ideally we would use A, B, and C, but since we are working with calculus this time, we'll use x, y, and z. It sounds better. And now let's make a tiny change dx to x, and let's see what happens to z. So it's supposed to be tiny, but I'm making it big so that it's more visible and more workable with. So this length is z plus dz. So z plus the tiny change in z that was caused by changing x. And now let's drop a perpendicular like this. So this angle is also a right angle, and this angle will be something really small. Let's make this theta. So this will be d theta. So we are not actually concerned with what d theta is, but the fact that it's really small is what we'll use. So since it's very small and this angle is a right angle, we can say that this angle is 90 degrees minus d theta. But since d theta is really small, we can basically say that this is also 90 degrees. So this is an isosceles triangle. So since this is an isosceles triangle, this length and this length are equal in the limit, at least. They're not actually equal, but in the limit they will be equal. And that means that this length is also z. So this is z. And since we know that the entire length is z plus dz, this must be dz. So this entire length is z plus dz, and this length is z. So now look what we have here. We have another right angle triangle. So let's zoom in on it. So we have the hypotenuse, which is dz, dx. And then we have a right angle there. This is dx and dz. And now this triangle is actually similar to our big one. Why is that? Because this angle is very close to 90 degrees, and this angle is 90 degrees minus theta. So if we call this angle, let's say something like A. So if I call that angle A, this is A, and this is 90 degrees minus A. So now if we prove that A is equal to theta, or A is equal to 90 degrees minus theta, then that means that this triangle is similar to this one, because the 90 degree angle is anyway common. So to prove that, it's very easy. This is 90 degrees, this is 90 degrees minus theta, so 90 degrees plus 90 degrees minus theta plus A is equal to 180 degrees, because this is a straight line. So that cancels out, that cancels out. So we get A minus theta is equal to 0. So A is equal to theta. So that means that this angle is nothing but theta. But now look what we have. If we talk about what sine theta is equal to dz by dx. And sine theta is also equal to x by z. So that means that the tiny change cos to z divided by the tiny change cos to x is equal to x by z. So if we rearrange this, we get x dx is equal to z dz. So integrating both sides, we get x square is equal to z square plus c. But notice that we also have another variable y, and we didn't talk about it at all. So this c can actually be any function of y, because f of y partial differentiated with respect to x is equal to 0, right? Because y doesn't at all change when you change x. So that means that the derivative of any function of y with respect to x will be 0, because it doesn't change at all. And that means that by symmetry, we can also argue that y square is equal to z square plus some new function g of x. So if you are not completely comfortable with how we can say this, you can basically apply the same argument by flipping this triangle like this and bringing the y side here and the x side here, and then you can again change y a bit and see what happens to z. The exact same thing will happen, because it's symmetric in x and y. But now if we subtract these two, then we get x square minus y square is equal to z square, and z square cancel, and we get f of y minus f of x. But now notice that since y and x are independent, we can say that f of y is equal to minus y square and f of x is equal to minus x square, because there is no x inside f of y and there is no y inside f of x. This is just a purely, it's just a function in purely y, and this is just a function purely in x. Because if it wasn't, then the partial derivative with respect to x wouldn't be 0. So we couldn't just add f of y like that. So that means that if we go back to this equation, then f of y is nothing but minus y square. So what we get by rearranging the equation is x square plus y square is equal to z square. And that is our Pythagoras theorem. Thanks for watching. Let's go.